Hello, and welcome to another Geotech Hour. I'm Dr. David Bray, your host and inaugural director of the Atlantic Council's Geotech Center, and we're here today for a lively discussion on the geopolitics of emerging technologies during the pandemic. Now, it's worth noting that if we went back in time to 2019, trying to get tech companies to talk about how they were influencing geopolitics was probably a really hard thing. It was something that, just like how when you go to California to take off the tie, you also don't really say, you know, how tech is impacting geopolitics, at least in 2019, because it was one of those things that may have been happening, but it was still one of those topics that people felt like we weren't ready to have that conversation. And what the pandemic has now done is it's made it easier for us to realize that the choices we make involving data and technology will impact not only how we respond to the pandemic, but how nations come back from the recovery in the years ahead. And so that's why this is an important conversation, because there are lessons we can learn both from 2020 and as we look forward to rebuilding and doing better after the pandemic in 2021 onwards, we can do so smartly thinking about data and tech. Now, I want to welcome a very special guest that is joining us from the embassy in Washington, D.C. We recently did do an event together with our colleagues in Finland about the geopolitics of tech and data and what we can learn from that. That was done in December. This is part of the continuing discussions with that. And I would like to welcome to the stage, to the Geotech Hour, Antti. Could you real quick share a little bit about what you do? And then even more importantly, why discussing these topics now are so important for us to do?
Thanks, David. It's great to be here, and thanks for the invite for the Geotech Hour. So for everyone, I'm Antti Niemelä. I head the section for sustainable growth and commerce in the Finnish Embassy in here, and our work is actually these days a lot about tech, and it's great to be here and really to discuss this topic. And David, you gave me kind of the task to look this from 30,000 feet perspective. I must say that I'm still not very familiar with the American measurements, so I have no idea how much 30,000 feet is. Right. But let's say I like to give the really global overall perspective. And from my perspective, really, there is three fundamental shifts going on at the moment in the world. There is the geopolitical shift, what you mentioned, really from one hegemon to multi-dimensional world with US-China superpower competition. There is the geoeconomics shift, the balance of economical center of the world moving steadily to east. We are not anymore in Atlantic-centric world, we are in Indo-Pacific centric world. I like to always show people in Finland also a map, because we were kind of brainwashed as kids that, you know, world is always Atlantic-centric, but obviously this has changed. And thirdly, there is the technological revolution with artificial intelligence and other solutions which really change the way how we do things. And these fundamental shifts, of course, affect us all in political sphere, in companies, in academia, in normal people. And the question is where the world is heading with this. And if I would be provocative, I would say there is two directions. There is the direction of the world dominated by apex predators, destroying the ecosystem and the systems of governance what we have had. Or there is the world which is more local, less global maybe, but which is solution oriented, where we look for local solutions for global needs. And the question is that all this discussion on geopolitics of tech is at core on where the world is going with these fundamental shifts. And I think I leave it there. I'm happy to discuss all these points more in detail.
Wow. Well, you painted the scene quite well, and I appreciate that, Antti, particularly as we think about, you know, the world we want to go to. And I know that Finland has always been sort of at the vanguard of doing foresight and actually doing strategic foresight in ways that I wish that the United States did itself. And we have a lot to learn from you. If I could ask a real quick rejoinder of you, as we look towards the future, Antti, and you talked about a world in which we look locally for global needs, maybe real quick, if you could highlight what might be one or two things that we want to be mindful of that steer us more towards that future versus the world in which we are destroying global norms and destroying what we've worked to build together globally.
Yeah, that's an interesting question, and I see a lot of movement in certain ways to the situation where the winner takes all, where really the apex predators dominate the ecosystem. I usually like to use an example of a Finnish lake with the fish ecosystem in the lake. You know, all of us Finns have usually a small summer cottage, nothing fancy, but small cottage next to a lake, a clean lake. And I don't like fishing, but still I sometimes fish from the lake. And the lake on the summer cottage my parents bought a long time ago, it used to have all these small fishes and a great ecosystem of fish. Nowadays, mostly I can catch pike. And pike is the apex predator in Finnish lakes. People from other parts of the world might not believe it, but it's the apex predator. And the challenge really there is that the dominance of pikes, of course, reduces the ecosystem, reduces the choice, and in the end makes also feeding from fish more boring and less healthy, because the apex predator actually takes all the heavy metals, also collects those, and pike is not the healthiest fish to eat. But really, it is competition in finance, in pushing technology through without being solution oriented. I think that's a danger, and there are many ways to address this. And I think the event what we had in December brought up very, very good points on addressing these. And to give one example is joint experimenting, public-private partnerships, regulatory sandboxing, where we could work together based on our value base to really find out how to work with new technologies, how to work with the geopolitical and geoeconomic shift towards a world which is solution-oriented and which doesn't leave all to these apex predators.
I love it. Well, and you're singing to the choir, partly because, one, I like being solution oriented, and I think you're absolutely right. That's a way that we can make sure we are very intentional and we can amplify things at the local level and not be forced to decide on things that are only sort of the big. We can also think about the small and how they can work together. And then also, I don't know if you know that when I did my dissertation, it was on knowledge ecosystems. So any reference to thinking about an ecosystem approach, I think is a really good way forward. So I thank you for that, Antti. And that's a good segue to another good colleague of the Geotech Center and probably the only one of the Geotech senior fellows that can claim they transit quickly from the operating room to a Geotech hour. And I'm really glad that you're joining us. Divya, you have a background in medicine, you have a background in healthcare, but you also do data science. What do you see as to the why in terms of what's happening with data and the use of health side technologies and the intersections with geopolitics?
It's a great question. And let me take it one step back. One of the things that the pandemic did was it revealed a lot of fracture lines in our geopolitical sphere. And I think it served as a global stress test for us. For those of you who've ever been to a doctor's office and had a stress test, I'd say the planet stopped pretty early because of chest pain, and then it fell off the treadmill. Sorry, I never get to use jokes like that. But the good thing is that this pandemic is not as deadly as some future pandemics might be. And so these fractures give us ample time to prepare and to understand the new tech that we're going to need. And I would say the very first lesson that I have at least taken from this is that in no uncertain terms, taking care of the most vulnerable amongst us is absolutely critical, because their health and well-being impact the most prosperous of us, the richest of us, the ones who are the most blessed. And many of them are essential workers in healthcare, but they drive our buses, they prepare our food, and their health impacts us. So we really should care. The second thing is we are so interrelated. Anybody who has seen the Earth from space has recognized that there really are no borders. And it's actually a fairly fragile biosphere. And viruses and pathogens, they know no borders. So we need to sort of participate as a global community in ensuring everyone is well. So the things, some of the lessons that I have taken away in terms of the acceleration of technology trends, one of them is actually telehealth. This is a way of connecting people. For instance, maybe they shouldn't be coming to hospitals because they're infected or others around them are infected. But in many cases, it's because they can't reach healthcare providers because of their remoteness. And this sort of trend towards telehealth to connect all of these people together is a really, really good thing. It's also accelerated the development of connected medical devices at the edge for remote monitoring of humans, IoMT devices. As you know, David, there are so many billions of devices that are already online. But none of this matters if it weren't for the second piece that I think is really, really important, and that is our physical connectedness. I think that we are accelerating technology trends towards broadband, satellite interconnectivity. Just like there are medical deserts on the planet, there have been broadband deserts where information doesn't reach everyone. I'm thinking of areas in rural US, places where indigenous people live in the world. This is a general problem across the globe. Another thing that's been highlighted for me, and I think someone else has a lot of expertise on this panel, in this area, but I'll at least mention it because it affects healthcare, and that's our distribution and supply chain weaknesses. I think now of things like getting healthcare resources to where they need to be, and we are seeing actually what's happening with vaccine distribution, not just in one country, but across the planet. And its fair distribution is really important as well. At the moment, high-income countries have captured most of the supply of vaccines, monoclonal antibodies. They do this, and we need to make sure that these things are more equitably distributed. And then moving to the data side, if we are using data to support all of these structures, we're going to need elevated cybersecurity. We're going to need data trust that we're taking people's data. We have a fiduciary responsibility to protect this. And finally, use of data in such a way that it is made clean, it's labeled and named well, it's made interoperable. That's going to be key because we want to deploy other method-based technologies like machine learning and deep learning. So basically artificial intelligence to help us in our fight to both detect new pathogens, to model new drugs, to fight pathogens, to repurpose old drugs that may work. And then finally to integrate data signals coming from all these disparate sources so that we can finally engage in an early warning system, an early detection system, much as we do for most of our natural disasters.
Wow. Well, there's a lot there to unpack, and I really like how you sketched out the different areas in which we're seeing impacts in healthcare and data. I also like how you opened up, Divya, talking about the thing that we need to think about those, you know, that we need to think about those who don't have nothing or have very little, because they are ones that we have an obligation to help for, and two, it interconnects and impacts us all. So thinking about those who may not have much when it comes to either data literacy skills or awareness about their data or even what's being done to their data. Maybe real quick, if you could give us a little preview that we can dive in deeper a little bit on, what would be your recommendations when you think about sort of helping those that may not have the data literacy skills needed for the future ahead?
Well, that sort of dovetails into education around data literacy. And that's not disinformation, because actually the pandemic was a brief. For those that are already need that sort of digital support, I think that we are going to have to devise networks and systems that, whether or not they realize they're participating in it, that they that these things are encrypted. And if they don't have devices, we can find hardware or paper or some way for them to interact with an otherwise digitally protected network. I think these networks have to be distributed. We can't have all the data in one place because it puts people at risk. But I think a lot of it is going to be in the same way as the data trust issue. It's going to be a fiduciary responsibility initially to think ahead. We can't keep commoditizing humans. We have to find a different incentive structure for alignment for companies to thrive and for humans to thrive together on this planet.
Well said, Divya. I want to amplify, and I really appreciate everything you're doing as a positive change agent, and really appreciate your remarks and joining us on the Geotech Hour. And that's a good segue now to our first-time guest on the Geotech Hour. So Karina, welcome. And it's also great that I want to note that we actually have three doctors. You are the second of the three doctors that are joining us. So if your background, in this case, I believe a PhD, be interested in your thoughts about what's happening in information technologies, the AI side of emerging technologies, and geopolitics as well, Karina.
Yeah, great to be with you, David. And, you know, for Google, artificial intelligence is a technology we've invested in for decades. And it's been very interesting to see in the pandemic, just the emergence of AI as a tool to actually help address the pandemic. So we're looking across the board, right? Divya mentioned some things around better scientific understanding of the virus, maybe better detection or better ideas for treatments. We're also seeing that AI is useful to help people find relevant information, helping small businesses connect to customers, of course, enormous economic impact with the pandemic, and then communicating across language barriers, right? The translation systems of today are much better than they were 10 or 20 years ago. And that's really thanks to a lot of the investment that's happened in AI. So, if you look at what actually matters for AI, there's four key elements that are needed. And even to Antti's comments around, how do we think about local solutions? A question that we've had a lot is like, are there commonalities? What are the pieces where we might even share some elements globally so that people can use them to find local solutions? So of the four things, the first is data, right? Divya spoke about this already, and you can definitely see many political and geopolitical elements here. How do you think about equity of data? How do you think about who's represented in the data? How do you think about making sure everybody has access to the data that matters? As Divya said, right, data doesn't care about borders per se, right? Whether a certain borderline falls somewhere, people are experiencing similar symptoms, right? So how do we think about that data, who has access and how it's shared? A second key element of AI is the models themselves, right? You can think in a most simple system, maybe like linear regression, like a y equals mx plus b that you might have learned in high school. But looking to where we are now, right, there's models with like millions or even billions, tens of billions of variables. How do we think about sharing them? Some of them, the better the models are, the better the predictions, right, the better, faster that you can get to potential solutions. So how do we think about sharing those models? Do we open source them? Again, how do we make them accessible for people to use? Can you make them in a way that enables more people to have access to them without maybe necessarily specific expertise, but they're able to use them? Same as we can drive a car, we don't all know how to build one. How do we think about that accessibility and thinking about kind of sharing the models? Third piece is processing capability. So all of the data, right, all of the models and predictions that are made, they actually still require hardware, largely made of silicon today, to process all of these data. And we're kind of seeing a continued shift, right? At the beginning, you had CPUs, right? Now, then GPUs for more graphical data. And we're looking at things like TPUs, tensor processing units, and other similar types of hardware to actually be very good at the matrix multiplication that's required for machine learning. So as we think about it, a lot of these issues that Divya had already brought up around supply chain, where are these manufactured? How do we think about building better and better chips? What happens when there are fractures geopolitically? How can we share? How can we think about local solutions so that we actually are still able to support the AI that's needed? And then the fourth element that really is critical here is talent, right? So all the data, the models, the hardware, they require people that are creative and smart and able to kind of design and use them. So how do we think about collaboration across borders? If you look at a lot of the scientific publications today, right, the number of international collaborations is enormous relative, again, to what was out there 10 or 20, 30 years ago. So how do we think about collaboration? How do we think about immigration? How do we think about workforce development and the ability to really use talent in a way that enables everyone to succeed across the globe?
Wow. Well, I really like the four pillars that you shared there, Karina. And maybe if I could ask a real quick rejoinder that builds on both Antti and Divya shared, which is, how can we do things locally, but think globally? And then as Divya has talked about the importance of data, we know one of the big challenges with data is interoperability. What someone calls pulse, someone else may call heart rate and things like that. Is there a case where different techniques, can the machines help us overcome the very barriers we humans impose on data in terms of interoperability?
Yes, definitely. So one good example from Google would be Google Translate. So Google Translate actually learns on data from across the web. And there's, millions and millions of examples that people have of translation. Some of them are great translations. And as you can imagine, there are also some pretty bad translations on the web. What we might call dirty data. And Divya talked about this idea of clean data. We're actually seeing a lot of advances in machine learning to actually be able to, we know we're never going to have a perfect data set. So what can we do to actually automate identifying, hey, these are good pieces of data, these are clean pieces of data, and these ones are like actually not so accurate or not so helpful. So let's try to cluster them over here. There's a lot of advances in things like graph learning, new models for neural nets and things to automatically clean data. It still does require human expertise, right? We've got to set a good example and say, these are good translations, these are not, but definitely some progress in that area.
Excellent. Well, as one who about 15, 20 years ago had to endure standard setting committees, if we can, anything we can do to get the humans out of the loop, I look forward to that. So thank you for that, Karina. I'm really glad you're joining us with the Geotech Hour here. And now we'd like to go to Andrea. Welcome back to the Geotech Hour. You're a senior fellow with us. We're really glad to have you here. You're also the third doctor joining us. I feel like I should go doctor. And you're going to give us your thoughts about how supply chains, because we've been sort of hinting at it, and we're really interested in your thoughts, as well as the idea of digital twins are being impacted by the pandemic and geopolitics.
Yeah, and thanks so much for having me back. I love these conversations, and I'm already learning a lot, so I love to participate in them. So with supply chains are interesting. It's great that they've already been mentioned a few times. And it's one of those things that, a year ago, it wasn't really something people talked about a whole lot, except for, those of us in our little esoteric groups that we like to talk about it. But now it's basically headlines. When I ask people about supply chains, at a minimum, they'll say, well, toilet paper. And that's kind of what they think about. but it's so much more than that. That's what resonates. The public has actually been impacted. And so that's what it is growing in awareness. And so it extends into all aspects of our lives, really. If you think about our national security with the technology, economic security with various kinds of job growth and development. Food security is a whole nother component of it as well. And there's been lots of food disruptions to the food supply chain over the last year. The COVID vaccine rollout, the impact of the supply chains, and then increasingly a democracy as well, which I think doesn't get as quite connected, but it really is, because we're starting to see the bifurcation. It's even more than a bifurcation, but just the splintering across the globe into various technospheres, and how they're looking at their supply chains really do impact democratic values and how we think about civil liberties. And even like what was talked about in the previous two speakers, as far as the data, who has access to the data? And so where your supply chain is, while the borders, definitely we're seeing as far as data flows, and we're looking at trade flows, and we see all the flows of pandemic, they are crossing borders. But at the same time, borders are non-intuitively mattering even more so as well at the same time. So we sort of have these competing forces going on, where you're increasingly required to store your data in certain countries, and increasingly there are laws that say, well, we can access that data as well if we want to from authoritarian regimes. And so there's the authoritarian and democratic view of supply chains really is starting to emerge, and it's all found, the undergirding of it all is the technology. And so when I think about supply chains and emerging technology and geopolitics, I always look at it sort of as the dual use component. So on the one hand, emerging technology is going to be essential for us to as we reinvent our supply chains. It's going to be essential at the very tactical level when thinking about workforce safety and the various kinds of automation that can make all of our lives and the workers' lives easier at that level. Operationally, there's a ton of interesting innovation and research going on for trucking and freights and so forth, especially when you think about their impact on climate change. There's a huge amount of room for innovation there that's already underway. And then strategically, to your point on digital twins, there's so much technology can do to help companies realize, how are they connected? And that's where, for many of the global brands, they have tens and up to hundreds of thousands of suppliers in their network. And for the most part, they know their first tier suppliers, but may not know many beyond that. And so when something happens across the globe, very often they're shocked that they're impacted by it, because they didn't know they had a core supplier, mm-hmm. in the Philippines or in Nigeria. You pick your location. There's view across that. They don't have that visibility, because over the last few decades, what we saw with supply chains was that they became very complex. The just-in-time production led to super hyper-specialization across the board, very opaque, and then very insecure as well. And that's alluded a little bit to the cybersecurity element of it. So we saw just really great fragility, and that COVID came along and just exposed fragility across all of those. So you see great room for innovation, but also sort of the chance for vulnerabilities, like SolarWinds. Is still, we're still trying to figure out what the impact of that's going to be, and that's the digital supply chain across the board. So it's a physical supply chain as well as a digital supply chain. And, you know, and again, just how democracies are going to move forward with that versus how authoritarian regimes are, and how, you know, decoupling, I'd argue, is not going to be both desirable or, you know, we're not really able to do so, at least not in the near term. But there is going to be some shifting away, right? So it's not to say, so it won't be that complete decoupling, but there will be that transformation. And that's what we're dealing with right now. What is that transformation going to look like? Is it going to be the surveillance tech goes across all the supply chains? You got the human rights violations and linkages there as far as supply chains. And then just really how to make them resilient, you know, and how to leverage what this big shock has done to rethink and innovate and reinvent our supply chains going forward.
Excellent. Well, I really appreciate the picture that you showed, because you're absolutely right. I mean, supply chains are all in the news right now, and they've come elevated to the light. If I could maybe borrow from the metaphors that we've gotten earlier from Antti as well as from Divya, you know, Antti talking about how we want to avoid a world in which it's just the apex predators, instead it's trying to think about an ecosystem, and Divya talking about how what COVID-19 was, we started having chest pains and then the world fell off the treadmill. If we want to go to a world that's getting back on track and starting to recover, if you could look into the future and make recommendations for policymakers around the world, should they play the game more as a nation state and double down on borders, or should they start thinking more about networks, networks that transcend their nation and things that go from there? So I don't want to throw you too hard a question, but I'd be interested in your thoughts about what might you recommend for folks. Yeah.
Well, and so benefiting from the various skill sets across the various, you know, from various within that network, and even it doesn't have to be an all or nothing work.
Said, and what I'm hearing is, yeah, you almost seem to be of two brains. One brain,
for people who've been saying globalization forever, you know, there's been rumors of the demise of the nation state for decades at this point.
I'm still waiting.
Yeah.
So thank you for that, Andrea. Really glad you're with us at the Geotech Hour. And now I'm going to sort of pivot to our guests and actually take us down from 30,000 feet or approximately 10,000 meters for Antti and our guests from Europe. We're now going to go down, we're going to take us down to 15,000 feet, and it's now going to get to the what. And I do want to encourage all our audience members, both those who are watching online, you can actually ask questions via Twitter, but those who are also in the Zoom room, please give us your questions. We are interested in them. And now we're going to go to the what, and what both has happened and what can we learn from this. And so I'm going to go first to Karina and say, was there anything that in particular we should have learned from what happened in COVID-19 and in the last year that we should then translate as we look towards 2021 and 2022 onwards?
Yes, so definitely with coronavirus, to give one example from our flagship product at Google Search, right? Starting probably last January, we saw a massive spike in searches related to coronavirus, which you can imagine we wouldn't have necessarily predicted for this. You can also imagine and maybe appreciate how hard this problem is, right? First of all, every single day, actually every single hour, you're getting completely new information on the web. And so for us to actually be able to surface that, we have to be able to do so in a scalable way, but also to understand the kind of information that's coming up every day. Secondly, a lot of the information is in all different forms, right? It's not just text. Like 20 years ago, it was probably all text. And today you've got text, images, video, audio, all different kinds of information that we were having to understand and actually process very quickly. Thirdly, you know, you're getting queries on the user end, right? Lots of different people, billions of people, in fact, using Google Search. And actually every single day, 15% of queries are completely new. We haven't seen that exact wording before. So you could imagine even somebody saying coronavirus or COVID-19, COVID pandemic, how do I, prevent spread? Like all of these things are related, and we have to be able to understand all of those different queries and try to surface the relevant information. And then finally, you can imagine, again, now people are not just searching in English, right? 20 years ago, that was probably largely the case. Today, people are searching in hundreds of languages. So we not only have to be able to do that in one language, we have to be able to do all of that in hundreds of languages. It's a really tough problem. And the biggest takeaway that we've really kind of seen among the many that are important from the pandemic is just the importance of R&D. This, we would not have been able to address a lot of these searches had it not been for the decades of investment in machine translation, in language understanding, in modeling, machine learning, processors all across the board. There's been important R&D investments. And again, because of these significant investments, we've been able to respond in a quick way. But, you know, 20 years ago, nobody would have anticipated a pandemic of this magnitude, both public health and kind of the economic crisis. But because of the investments that were made, because it was thought, hey, language translation might be important, language understanding might be important, finding information might be important, these things were able to be then deployed very quickly. So I think the importance of R&D is very, very clear here. Second piece that I might just touch on quickly is that open resources really can empower others, right? So what we've seen, we talked already a bit this hour around data, and we've seen, for example, Pfizer, all the great work that they're doing, for example, in Israel, able to get these vaccinations up and going and deployed quite quickly, right? We've seen that being able to share data on community mobility, how people are moving around, search trends, being able to share open models. These are things that have empowered lots of people locally. And so thinking about ways that we can use openness in the right ways to actually share the benefits of all of the investments that have been made in R&D.
I really appreciate those remarks, especially that you talked about how, like, what we can do with data and what we can do with machine learning can help us sort of act locally and think globally. I think that's something that's needed because we know humans have a hard time thinking beyond our immediate environment. And if anything, we, you know, here we are all in still in lockdown with COVID-19, yet we're supposed to be thinking of a world that's now 7.8, 7.9 billion people. That's hard to do. If I could ask you real quick, as a quick rejoinder real quick, Karina, as we look towards a world where, you know, I know it was about 2 years ago, we hit the tipping point where half of the planet now was connected to the internet. We're probably now at about maybe 4 billion out of 7.8, 7.9 billion people connected. I mean, I know projections are we're going to bring on another 3 billion people in the next 5-6 years, which is amazing. Could you give us a little hint? You talked about the importance of R&D. Is there additional R&D needed to handle the load from going from 4 billion to 7 billion in just 5 years?
Definitely. So R&D is definitely going to continue to be important. I think, you know, some of the points made earlier around even broadband and how do you think about access and building in the physical infrastructure, that's all really important, being able to do so in a scalable way. I think if you look even just on the software side of things, you know, bringing on an additional 3 billion people, that's a lot of other languages, for example, that you're going to have to provide information in. And one of the interesting trends that we're seeing is actually kind of the move to even more powerful models. So if you think about languages, to use that example, right, there's a lot of existing data in English or Spanish or Mandarin Chinese, but there really isn't so much data in Amharic or Indonesian or other languages that are lower resource on the internet. So there's a trend actually towards building these larger models, what we've termed multipod models, to be able to actually take what you've learned from a larger don't speak languages that are super common. So building on top of those English and Spanish and Chinese models to actually support others. And that's just one example in language, but we're seeing that that's going to be very useful in machine vision, in translation, in language understanding, and so much more. So yeah, definitely continued investment is important.
Fascinating. And I really find it fascinating that you can use training on other languages to help with other languages. I mean, that just points to there may be some universality to how human language is constructed, even if we don't understand what it is yet. That's quite fascinating. So Antti, I know you're a big fan of talking about how we can share perspectives, not just transatlantically, but as you said, thinking about the world as a whole, perspectives from Europe, Asia, around the world. What would be your identification of both what can we learn from 2020 and how can we carry that forward into 2022 onwards, Antti?
Yeah, before turning to that, David, actually, I want to comment on the language.
Sure, go ahead.
I really feel your pain coming from a small language group. You know, Finnish is not the biggest data point on languages in the internet, unfortunately. So the results on translation software might not be as good as from English to Spanish or so forth. And also, you know, really, it's exciting always to hear open data mentioned. You know, the global open data movement is headquartered in Finland, and this is, of course, something which we look very positively on, how we can utilize open resources to foster innovation and move things forward. But then, David, to your question, I would raise 3 points and then one kind of panic point in addition to that. The first point, what we really learned is the importance of trust. And in Finland's case, we can see the success of the corona tracing applications, which globally, those mainly failed. Even in the beginning, we believe that those are essential for managing the pandemic. But only really in a couple of places, including Finland, the uptake was that high that it really had a positive impact on preventing the spread of the virus. And that was very much based on trust, on transparency, on information sharing. There was a lot of concerns in the beginning, but because of the open architecture of that system, that anybody could check the code, anybody could have access to that and knowledge about what are the risks and how well privacy is protected, made it easy for people to trust. So trust is paramount, and of course it's a very challenging thing to build trust generally, and once it's lost, it's even harder to do that. The second one is the one what I already mentioned, so joint experimenting, and that came also very strongly in the event or discussion we organized jointly in December. So really in these kind of situations when we have a huge number of emerging technologies sprouting around and everybody's running to see how to use this ethically, how to benefit the society as a whole with these new technologies. And of course, government always running a little bit behind to regulate what is really not ethical or beneficial usage of the technology. So these regulatory sandboxes and other joint experimenting really is the way forward, where, for example, in transatlantic cooperation, we could do something to get our regulators on the same page, get our companies on the same page, and really create a platform and a regulation which allows innovation and at the same time make sure the technology is used for the best of the society. And in Finland, for example, in AI sense, we had this AI challenge for companies where companies could propose these kind of self-regulatory systems for themselves for ethical use of AI. And the third point is inclusiveness that also came very much up in December, and I think it's essential, and that connects of course to trust, that people can trust only systems and rules which have been formed in inclusive process and where people feel that they have ownership or stake in that process. And that's really citizen-centric is the word what we like to use, that all these developments should be citizen-centric. Then the panic point, what has been bothering me a little bit lately, is actually money or finance. Now, with the pandemic, we saw that the world is capable of gathering resources, financial resources to do things and move things forward, which is great to see. Of course, we saw that that's not maybe globally very equal a distribution of those resources. And now when we move from pandemic towards probably austerity in the future, how can we assure to have those resources what are needed in this global competitive environment, that all this good work, all these good solutions actually have a chance to compete against those solutions which would not be so beneficial for us, which would have different geopolitical or geoeconomical implications. So that's something which I am happy to discuss with anybody with a bottle of wine in the future too.
Well, and that actually tees into a question we just got, Antti, as you were giving your remarks from the audience. And so if I could ask you real quick, and maybe any of our other panelists who want to chime in real quick too, John asked the question. He says, what are some activity or policy approaches? He asked about the United States, but let's think about any country, about doing internationally to use technology to advance the economic recovery. And so you hinted on, Antti, the concern that we may have spent a whole lot of money trying to get out of the pandemic, but now we're going to have austerity afterwards. Are there cases to be made to policymakers that if you use this technology, you won't have to be as austere because your economic recovery will be better? And so maybe I'll go first to Antti and then anyone else who wants to chime in.
I think that what the pandemic has really done, it has restructured the global market and opened it for new ideas, new solutions, and especially, of course, technology plays a big part on these. Like we named my team as sustainable growth and commerce from trade and economic affairs. That shows where Finland is going. We strongly believe that now after pandemic, with new technologies, with new solutions, we can head for sustainable growth. And there's huge potential on that front. And of course, sometimes it even saves so much money that it's a no-brainer as an investment. But definitely, we should invest in that kind of solutions. And for example, now when production is starting, to make sure that we protect climate better with the power what we produce for those solutions and so forth, and trade around the world where it's going. So of course, there is always great opportunity in crisis, and we can build back better, how you like to say here in US, and build back more sustainably, like we like to say in Finland.
Excellent, I really appreciate it, Antti. That's a great overview. And Divya, I see you have a rejoinder, so I'm gonna go to Divya next. Divya?
I just want to play off something that Antti said, which I think was really important, and that was the sustainability piece of this. This pandemic, not entirely, but in some part, was due to the effects of human activity on the biosphere, climate change, things of that nature. For people who maybe aren't making a complete connection, for instance, one of the things is our agritech and our production of things like meat products. Whether it's factory farming or wet markets, we are confining animals to situations of high density, high stress, and frequent contact with humans. And so pathogens jump zoonotically. Another issue is that it's causing animals and humans to begin to impinge upon one another's habitats. And animals are often finding themselves in places they shouldn't be. Permafrost is melting, and viruses that have been submerged and frozen in the permafrost tens of millions of years that our immune systems have never encountered, or we're finally going to see this. So I think that this has been a wake-up call to a shift towards sustainability, something I've always hoped for, but maybe this this could be a little bit of a tipping point. And I'm certain that we can build economies based on sustainable ideals. One thing we might have to consider in the future going forward is that unrestrained growth at all costs shouldn't necessarily be the only driving incentive. We can do things sustainably with the correct scale.
Very well said, and I really appreciate those insights, Divya, and I agree with you 100%. And it's also about sustainability, not just of the planet and its resources, but sustainability of our attention as people, of our societies, making sure this gets back to Antti's point about, let's make sure we don't end up with a world with apex predators, because that might be a loss for the species as a whole and the planet as a whole. I'm now gonna go to Andrea. We actually have a question from the audience that's actually twofold. One's coming from Pablo in the Zoom room, but we also got a question from social media, and they're both similar, which is, as pointed out, supply chains don't recognize borders. And so who should the monitoring fall to? Should it fall to each of the different national governments out there, a combination of it? How do we actually address the question of monitoring supply chains? I'd be interested in your thoughts, Andrea, with that question there.
Yeah, and you know, it's one of the things that I think how it was in the past where supply chains didn't really recognize borders.
Yeah, you're good.
The thing pop up. They don't recognize borders, but they increasingly are recognizing borders. And I think there's this switch, and that's why there's a good quote from an article in Project Syndicate basically that says the fact that everyone's thinking that we're gonna return back to normal from before is a collective failure of imagination. And that's how I view how we look ahead at, and it's true, I think, in so many different areas. I'll talk specifically about supply chains. And I think assuming that we're just gonna keep going back to the just-in-time production, the hyper-specialization, assuming that national security and borders don't matter, I think we're moving beyond that. And it's gonna be slow, and there's for sure, it's not homogenous as far as in different industries and different companies. Like, you're gonna see huge variation across that, but some are already starting to see it, and understanding that. One, the geographic concentration risk all in one area is a huge bottleneck and a huge source of fragility of their supply chains, and a huge source of risk. So mm-hmm. It impacts their operational resilience. But what we're also seeing on the one hand sort of the shocks that are coming to companies because of this geographic concentration. And for a lot of that, that is in China, right? And that's become paramount. And it's not due to the lockdown from COVID, but also there was, you know, enormous flooding that went on that also in certain industries was very disruptive. And then there's been the you know, ongoing linkages to human rights violations and that being manifest. And so it's across the board, different areas of geographic concentration risk that are impacting so many different areas. And so while companies are starting to realize that shock and that borders are starting to matter, at the same time, governments are switching the incentives structure as well. And so what we're seeing, you know, in the US, over the last 2 years, commerce has issued over 350 different prohibitions against Chinese companies. So restrictions against various kinds of trade with those companies within your supply chain. And so those compliance costs can be huge. You know, and you know, OFAC had some record-breaking compliance component that's in Treasury in 2019. And so that's huge in the US. So, you know, adjusting the incentive structure for who can even be in your supply chain, governments are stepping in. And that's, and importantly, it's not just the US. So that the big number is coming from the US, but you know, the tariff and trade war, you know, specifically with China, you know, Australia and the battle over wine, well, it led to some interesting commercials that were kind of fun. First, Australians trying to gather more democracies to come to their aid and buy their wine, and it worked, actually. you know, it goes beyond that. You know, as far as, you know, Huawei and ZTE and 5G, you've got Australia, you know, India, you know, Italy, Germany, UK, like, you know, so many of the different democracies coming in. India has banned hundreds of Chinese apps. Japan has issued incentives to reshore out of China. They did over $2 billion last year. They just did this week announced another $2 billion to incentivize their domestic champions to reshore away. And so we are seeing that the government is stepping in at the same, it's almost these two different forces. The government's shifting the incentive structure, and these various kinds of shocks and concentration risks are starting to impact the bottom line. And so that's how which is the growing motivation for, you know, many companies. And so you see those different momentum on both sides is shifting the way the borders are impacting supply chains.
Excellent. Well, I appreciate that. And so we have three questions and we've got about 3 or 4 minutes before we go to lightning round. So I'm going to go to first to Divya with one of the first questions we have remaining from the audience, which came from Desiree, who asked, what can we do about bringing access to technology to farmers, students in Africa, such as AI and things like that? So Divya, maybe real quick, if you could give some thoughts on that real quick. Nope, and you're muted.
Just unmuting now. Yeah, that's a brilliant question. And I might even combine it with an answer to Krista's question that I just saw in the
sure,
Q&A.
Yeah, you can.
I think that bringing this kind of technology and access to, basically to the edge is going to involve two components. It's maybe three components. One, it's the actual hardware and technology itself. Karina talked about that as well. And that also will enable the computing power. Second, it's the educational component, right? So you can't really access tech and data if you don't have that support access from the editing that it seems like all of the panelists have. Mm-hmm. And what do I mean by this? Everybody's alluded also to the explosion of IoT devices. The majority of those devices are not secured. The majority of those devices are capturing and giving away biometric data that people don't even recognize is being given away. So let me perhaps use this as a chance to get on my other horse to say, I really think that we need a complete overhaul of our data structure, our internet structure, and the way we share data. This might get a little bit to Krista's question, but also how do we avoid surveillance states while we are capturing data for the sake of the public good? Because we have to find a way for these two mandates to coexist. And so one thing I would suggest that people look into is there are actually future internet architectures that have been proposed. We have the internet we have, it grew organically, but it was never designed to protect commerce, to protect biometric data, to get permissions and to encrypt. And so there are other architectures that put layers on top of the TCP/IP layer. For those of you who are out there who don't know exactly what that is, it's the way in which we connect to the internet. It's how your laptop or your phone actually has an address that is recognized so it can talk to other devices on the internet. There are layers you can put in between that actually change the way that addressing system works, where things can, for instance, be addressed by content now. Many of these future architectures involve that. That doesn't sound revolutionary, but it actually is, because once you start addressing things not by where they reside, but what data and information they contain and how they're named, you can start encrypting them from the moment that they are produced, and enabling, whether people are digitally naive or not, giving them the power to digitally encrypt what they produce at the moment that they produce it, protects their data at rest and in motion. And if we also develop trust, we're saying, you don't necessarily need to know my bank account kind of understanding, we could create the collecting, this is why we're collecting it, and this is the public good. And if we protect that data and take no more than we actually need, would you give your permission? So if we can create those kinds of systems and get advanced permissions, we can have that more open sort of data sharing model where we protect people because the data is encrypted as it's produced, and then it can be temporarily decrypted for these kinds of use cases. So that's how I'm sort of getting on my soapbox about how we can protect the planet while sharing data. So
excellent. I appreciate it. And so now we're gonna sort of pivot to the lightning round, but I'm gonna ask each of you to not only in the lightning round, give us maybe two or so action items that you recommend for either public sector or private sector leaders, but I'm also gonna ask you a real quick question because we got some questions coming in at the last minute, and I'm gonna try and incorporate them in, but try to keep your answers ideally to about 1 minute on answering the question and then your two or three tweet length recommendations. And so first, Andrea, a question for you that's been asked about supply chains. If you could say some recommendation for the new administration, the Biden administration, that could be thought of as international, involving supply chains, but also broadband and new ways of doing mobile communications. 1 minute to answer that, and then your one or two tweet length recommendations for other steps that we should consider.
Yeah, that's a lot. So recognition from Biden. So you know, I wrote a quick article on this somewhat that really looking holistically at supply chains and not looking at not just on the trade component, but looking at it across like multidisciplinary angle to a holistic approach to supply chains. And for that very reason, because the tech standards come along with it. And so you see a lot of push by authoritarian regimes trying to shape the standards and norms for everything from what goes into mobile communications to, even how to plug in things. Or how to process and collect data, like Divya was talking about. So looking at, a holistic supply chain strategy that really looks beyond supply chains as just, as industrial policy and trade, but look at it as a mode for spreading democracy and ensuring democracy, as a mode for, and for that alone includes the data protection, the internet standards and policies, basically cyber norms can even go into that, because again, going back to solar winds, that's how it permeates throughout the supply chain. So I just would love to see supply chain just elevated because of the impact across there. And even, like we've talked about, the sustainability and the climate change and helping provide incentives to help further encourage innovation in these areas that both help with the reshoring as needed, but also doing it in a way that helps build the trusted networks across, again, to Auntie's point, building those networks that are of trusted, shared partners, and ensuring as well that within that those networks that you do have the capabilities for self-sufficiency for very critical areas like we've seen in the pandemic, so that doesn't happen again.
Excellent. Well, thank you for that, Andrea. I'm now going to go to Divya. Divya, you get to give your two or so tweet length recommendations for action for leaders. And also, we've gotten a question that came in for you, which is, could you share some of the architecture initiatives? Again, fairly short, but someone's asked if you could share some of the architecture initiatives that can empower people in new ways.
Sure. Very quickly, for that person who asked, one of them is called the NAME Data Network, but there are a few others out there. And if you look up NSF and of FIA, which stands for Future Internet Architectures, you can see a number of these funded initiatives to achieve privacy and security while creating open sort of data sharing structures. As far as my tweet length sort of responses, I believe we need to realign incentives to make selling humans' data and their attention not the sole model for making money. Mm-hmm. I think that leaders need to understand that growth at all costs are not going to support a healthy planet or healthy humans. So we need new models. And finally, I think we should be instrumenting our planet to listen to the signals that she is sending, instrumenting soil, water, atmosphere, space, so that we can create both a digital nervous system for our planet as well as a digital immune system.
Excellent. Well, thank you for that, Divya. Now, Karina, going to go to you. We have a question that we got from Andrew Mack about how one can use technology to build trust. And I know that's probably shorter than a 1 minute answer, but if you could give us an early preview, maybe we can invite you back to a future Geotech Hour. What are thoughts about how technology can help build trust, and then your two or so tweet link recommendation for action?
Yeah, I think it's an important question, right? Like any tool, you can use it kind of for the good of everybody, or it can be used in harmful ways. And trust, Auntie, I think, pointed to this idea as well, is it's pretty much critical. In order for technology to be useful, people have to use it. And people aren't going to use it if there isn't trust there. So I think there's a lot of discussions there. Certainly could spend a much longer time discussing this, but there are efforts. I'll just name a few around kind of things like trustworthy data sources, equity in data, federated learning, to have that privacy and security even as you are learning kind of useful information and sharing that globally. I think there's a lot of different pieces here where it's not, you don't have to have the either or, you can have the both and there's a lot of technological solutions in that vein. You can check out, for the person who asked the question, you can check out at least for what Google's doing here, ai.google/responsibilities. There's quite a lot of information on the technical work that we're doing, but still definitely early stages and a lot more to do. In terms of recommendations, I've got two. One is really just the importance of continued investment in R&D. I think it's tough, right? We don't have unlimited money. And so the trick really will be figuring out what are the important things that we need, what capabilities might we need, but let's definitely invest there because we will probably be using them in the decades to come. The second point is really to identify the right governance, whether it's norms or standards, self-governance, regulation, so that we can be open in all the areas we can be, right? Just to underscore, Ansi had mentioned this point on kind of economic availability. We don't have unlimited money. So what can we do to share relevant resources so we don't all have to recreate the wheel? There are important topics like the pandemic, climate change, sustainable development goals, so many things where there are global problems. And if we work together, at least sharing common resources where it makes sense, we can just make a lot more progress.
Very well said, and really appreciate it, Karina. And definitely, we'll have to do another Geotech Hour if you're welcome to come back on how we can use technology to build trust, because I think that could easily be a whole nother session. So thank you for that. So Auntie, you get to bring it home for us, both interested in your 2 to 3 tweet length recommendations. And we also have a question from an anonymous attendee who asked the question, how can we make sure we don't end up in a world in which it's more about authoritarian values? How can we sort of encourage a world that's still about openness and people having individual choice? I know that's, again, 1 minute answer, but interested in your thoughts there, Auntie.
Yeah, I can again have a bottle of wine with the person asking that question. But I think building trust is essential. And of course, Divya's point about using and people's choice on trustworthiness of technology. I can give example on our Corona app, which a famous hacker made an analysis that actually asks less details regarding your privacy than in general, you know, flashlight app on your phone. And the question really should be why flashlight app needs to have any personal data. What does it need it for? And so I think in interest of time, that's pretty much what I can contribute now. But I think it's that's an essential question, what we think a lot. And I must say, David, that you know, the panel, what you have collected for this has kind of motivated me that I should go back to university also to join all these doctors. But a few points for the tweet. And I think this actually answers also partly to the question. Experiment together. Be solution oriented always, foster trust, be inclusive and transparent, always transparency is important, and finally find the money somewhere to do this.
I love it, especially Auntie, and your point is so well taken, which is in this environment which we're all learning, we always have to be continuously learning, and it's really been an honor to have you, Auntie, have Karina, Andrea, and Divya. I do think this is probably one of the most doctorated Geotech Hours we've recently had. So thank you all for bringing and elevating the conversation. To everyone who joined us and everyone who asked questions and everyone who's a positive change agent, thank you. And as always, please be bold, please be brave, and please be benevolent for the future ahead. Thank you again.